Hi, I'm Aky Karim, and we're here on the sofa with none other than Mr. Zelfa Brown Flash Barrett and Mr. Sean Benn Mulligan. This is for our new TV online show. It's BBTV, but in my head, I'm calling it BOXMANIA. Now, we've got two boys here from Collyhurst and Moston Boxing Gym, and we're going to be having a little chat with them. First of all, Zelfa, Mr. Brown Flash, just come off a big first round knockout of Mr. Elvis Gillian. And I'm telling you, Elvis did leave the building, because you got him out of there in round number one. Talk us through that fight.
Basically, the whole plan was to get 8 rounds out. He was a durable opponent. We picked him because he was tough, he was strong. And all I'd done was, whatever I'd done in training, just put it into the fight. I wasn't even in gear one, I was in parking.
Yeah.
And then, whatever it was, it just happened.
Now, you said earlier that when you threw that body shot, you didn't feel it. Talk us through like what it feels to land like a perfect shot.
Any shot you land, it feels like you've not hit him. If you hit someone with a left hook and the chin, it feels like it's just wind. Yeah. Like you've hit fresh air. So when I hit him to the body the first time and like he stepped back, I thought, okay. So I hit him with a right hook to the head to put his hands up again. Yeah. And I felt the last body shot when I hit him with it, but the first one, I didn't feel it.
So this guy's mean. He hurt him with the body shot and then he goes back down there straight again. I mean, the guy's come all the way from Argentina and you couldn't let him have 2 rounds, get 2 rounds out of it.
That was the plan. I wanted rounds. I wanted to show my skills. I wanted, because it was live on TV.
Yeah.
I wanted everyone to know that how good I am.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How dedicated I am to the sport, how I'm like a student to the sport. And I was a bit gutted for the fact that he went down because I wanted to show everyone what I can do.
Fair enough. But as they say, you don't get paid for overtime and all that. So you're in the super featherweight division? And Sean, what sort of weight are you in at the minute?
Welterweight.
So have you guys ever done any sparring in the gym together?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. We've loads of learning sparring.
Go on then. How's that been? How's that gone? Who's got the upper hand there?
To be fair, we've not sparred for years.
We've not sparred for years, but he's just learning.
He's a little whippet.
He's a little whippet. And then when you land, because I felt Sean Benn Mulligan's power, body shots, big body shots. I felt both their powers, to be honest. Serious punches. What motivates you guys? What do you want out of the boxing game? So I'll go to you, Benny. Go on. What do you want out of the boxing game?
Well, I want to be a champ first and foremost. I want to be a champion.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's why I'm in the sport, and that's why I think most fighters are in the sport for. Obviously, it's our livelihood, isn't it? So yeah, you're in it as well. Obviously, to earn money and earn a living.
Yeah.
But first and foremost, to be a champion. You know, the dream is to be a world champion.
Yeah. Now, for those of you that aren't familiar with Sean Benn Mulligan, you're 5-0 at the minute.
Yeah.
You've got a 1 knockout at the minute.
Yeah.
How would you describe your style?
Sort of box fighter, come forward, a lot of head movement, a lot of slipping, a lot of rolling.
Yeah. Yeah.
Angles. So the pressure fighter, really.
So a little bit like, because I was in the gym with you, and we're going to show you some great footage of both of these guys in the gym doing some masterclasses. Hi, I'm Aky Karim. I'm here with BBTV for this brand new show. I'm here with none other than Mr. Zelfa Brown Flash Barrett. He's 13-0 and he's coming for you. And he's gonna do a masterclass for us today on how to throw a body shot. So I've heard, you're not gonna hit me too hard, are you?
No.
Because otherwise I'll get my lawyers on you. And
I can imagine it.
I'm not even joking. So here we go, we're about to do this, right? Zelfa, why throw a body shot? Why would you throw body shots?
Body shots, they weaken your opponent.
Yeah.
And you feel it all the way through the fight. If I hit you with a correct body shot in round 2, you feel it from round 2 to round 12.
But you didn't even need it to round 2 last time, did you? Because you took 1 round to get Elvis out of the building, didn't it?
Yep, just all that was down to is practice.
And what I liked about that is you hit him down to the body first, you seen it hurt him, and you went straight back down there showing your nasty side as well.
Yep.
Alright, so what you're looking for, you switch it as well, aren't you?
I can do.
So when you're looking to throw a body shot, what is it you're looking for? What's the main things?
What I look for is if the elbows are up like this.
Yeah.
Because if
their
elbows are up, you can sink the body shots in.
Yeah.
And then I throw a jab, and I throw a jab to the body. So I'm disguising the body shot, so I'm going to throw a jab to you. Jab to the body, and I'll fake, and I'll go around.
Right, okay, I see. And are there different ways to walk someone onto a body shot, or is it generally the same sort of setup?
Different fighters have different ways. Some fighters are aggressive,
yeah,
and they come forward.
So if I'm an aggressive come forward fighter, how are you going to get that body shot in?
I'm going to hit you with a jab,
yeah.
Keep hitting me with a jab,
yeah.
I'll shoot it through the middle,
yeah.
I'll hit you with a jab, I'll throw a hook to the head,
yeah.
See your hands go up,
yeah.
And then I hit you with the body.
And even them little taps, I can feel them little taps as well. You're going to dig one in for me?
Do you want me to?
Yeah, go on.
Nah, I can't. I'll let my wrist have got no wraps on.
Oh, give me 25%.
All right, right. I'll give you 25%.
25%
on you.
Yeah.
Boom, boom. I drop.
Alright, okay.
Elvis went down, he didn't go down.
I know, yeah, he didn't go down, he took that. I stayed up
on my feet there. And what if the fight is a southpaw? How would you move him into position here? So if
I touch her, then I shoot straight down the middle.
Yeah.
Or come on the side.
Okay, so would you, any young fighters coming up, would you say to them, make sure you're getting the body shots in, make sure you do the work to the body?
Basically, the body doesn't move. The head moves,
yeah,
but the body doesn't move. So it's a bigger target. So you can keep hitting someone to the body, because it's a bigger target. And It's effective. Don't get me wrong, hit him to the chin, it goes to sleep.
Yeah.
But someone might have a tight defence.
Yeah.
So it's like putting a tree down, you just keep chopping, and eventually they'll fall.
Right, well listen, there you go. This is Mr. Zelfa, Brown Flash Barrett. He's 13-0, he's coming for you. Next masterclass we're gonna get with him will be something a little bit different. This one's the body shot. Power!
Zelfa, what motivates you then as to fight?
To be a world champion. No, nothing below that, like. Becoming a British champion is an achievement, but I want to be a world champion.
Yeah.
And I believe I'm going to become a world champion.
Yeah. Now, speaking of world champions, you've actually been in the ring sparring with two world champions at lightweight, Anthony Crawler, Million Dollar Crawler, and Terry Turbo Flanagan. You sparred with both of them. Now, I suppose you can kind of get what angle I'm coming at next.
Of course.
Who's better?
You know what? To me, they're 50-50.
Because
Terry's fast and Crawler's very strong.
Yeah.
So it's like a Marvin Hagler versus like a Sugar Ray Leonard kind of a fight. It's a 50-50 fight.
They're both
super fit. The best man will win, and I hope it happens.
All right, so do I. And that's what you call good media training there. I didn't want to say we're 24. I like that. So we've all come back to this point here because we've got Sean Ben Mulligan over here. And now he hasn't got a nickname. We've got the Brown Flash here. We've got loads of other people in the gym. We've got the Dynamite Kid. We've got, what's Lyndon King Arthur.
Yeah, yeah.
Got all these sick names, right? And we ain't got one over here. So what we're going to actually ask is, we're going to actually ask people to tweet in a nickname for Sean Ben Mulligan. I personally like the Bruiser because I felt the body shots. But can we please tweet in? Can we get a little Twitter thing at the bottom there or something like that? Wow. We can get a little Twitter thing there at the bottom. Tweet in, please. Nickname for Sean Ben Mulligan. Okay, I'm going with the Bruiser. I mean, believe it or not, right, look, you know, you won't be able to tell this looking at me, but I'm actually big on the grime scene. Yeah, UK grime. Now, I've noticed that you've popped up. I've noticed that you in particular have popped up in a couple of Bugsy Malone videos. How does boxing and, like, music, the scene go? They seem to be going hand in hand together. Are you ever going to get, has Bugsy Malone come out and done, wrapped you into the ring or anything?
No, not yet anyway, but...
Is that something that could be on the cards?
Potentially, when I fight for a world title or a big massive title, could potentially be on the cards.
Listen, if Stormzy can do it for AJ, then Bugsy can do it for you.
True.
One thing I liked what you said as well in a recent thing I watched about you, I think it might have been with British Box as well actually, you said something that these guys are standing in the way of you buying your mum a house.
Yeah, of course.
I liked that. I was like, oh, that's good. So is that something that, I mean, you don't want to start off with something small like buying an Xbox first, you want to go straight for a house?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So. That's the goal. Yeah. You know, I mean, don't get me wrong, becoming a world champion, but that's just the goal for me. So my mum never has to work again.
Yeah, that's nice. That's nice.
So it's like a gift back from whatever she done for me.
Yeah.
It's just a gift back to her.
See, they both hit hard, but they're both sweet boys, really. Yeah. Deep down.
If it weren't for your mum and dad, you won't be where you are now, would it? Yeah. Or your mum, so.
Mm. And that's nice to hear from young fighters saying as well, of course. That brings me nicely onto this next little segment, the random round. Right? So I'm going to ask you, because you guys obviously, I mean, am I right in thinking you guys train together every day, pretty much?
Yeah.
So you know each other pretty well.
Yeah.
So I want you to be honest. Now, I know you've done a little segment like this before on British Boxers, and I really enjoyed it. I'm going to ask you a few questions. I want to know who's the best. It's like a head-to-head, right? Okay, now I know you're both like all like modest and all that. Forget all that crap. Just go for it. So, head-to-head, who's got the best jab out of you two?
Delfa. This year we're talking. I'm on the street, yeah. Anyone that wants to... We did a bit of a summit similar with British Boxers a few months ago. And you would have thought it's like... Every shot, every question I got asked, it was Zelfa, but... I've got to be honest, Anna.
All right, then, pound for pound, who hits the hardest?
Obviously, Ben's heavier, so...
But pound for pound.
What do you mean?
I'm like imagining you're both the same weight. Like on these pound for pound rankings.
If you would talk, you've got a look on paper, he's got a lot more knockouts than me, honestly.
He's so modest.
He's got to be
a... I felt them both.
I don't like this question.
I'm not a liar.
All right. Who's got the biggest, and I mean the biggest, male cosmetic bag? Male cosmetic bag. Who's takes the most time like with your male cosmetics?
What, in like the shower and stuff?
Yeah.
This guy, man. Oh my gosh. Obviously, you have to be, it's hygiene and clean.
Yeah.
But this guy in the shower, he just, it's like he lives in it, man. You can hear him like, ah. It's like, come on, Ben. Like, 1 minute, 1 minute. He's in the shower for like 10 minutes.
So what noise does he do in the shower?
Oh, yeah, it sounded a bit wrong, though, didn't it? Oh,
that's all right, that's all right. Who's the best at who's the best at football?
We're both with footballers, so.
Both, yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
All right. And do you guys play FIFA together?
Nah, you know what? I played it once and I beat him, so.
I've seen you on Instagram.
2013, this.
Yeah, 2013, man.
And we're in what now, 2016? You can't hold on to that forever.
I had a fight as well, so mine was on the fight.
Yeah. All right, fair enough. All right, we'll give you that one. Who's the most sensitive?
Don't know. Both mummy boys, so.
Yeah.
It's a close one.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a close one.
Same sort of person, like.
Yeah.
Yeah, who's the most generous out of you two?
Both generous.
Both generous.
All right, okay, I get where this is going. Who's got the best defence?
Ben. I'd say Ben.
Yeah.
Because from what you come from, when he first comes to the gym, if Ben don't mind me saying this, he was like, target practice.
Right.
And you know what? It got to the point where I was like, Pat, man, just I don't want to throw him no more.
Yeah,
because obviously you have to crawl before you can walk, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then now his defence, just like, he's got it.
Yeah.
He can just walk you down and then you're on the rope. So he come from a long way from what he did have. So I'd say Ben.
Yeah. Cool. So we're about to do a little segment with James Largey. You know, he's doing some strength and conditioning stuff with you. That's going to be called The Sweet Science. Now, what sort of stuff have you been doing with James?
Listen, I can't thank James enough. I've been doing. It put me through a lot of pain, but we've been doing a lot of stuff. I can't even say the names that we've been doing, but
yeah.
You see, from my body wise, like in one of my fights, I was just different. Like I felt it mentally, physically.
Yeah.
I just felt like there's no super featherweight that could touch me.
All right, Brent. Well, we're gonna cut to that interview now. Get James on the sofa. All right, welcome back. I'm here with none other than Mr. James Largey, Coach James Largey, one of the principals of FLF. Performance Centre in Manchester, massive boxing fan, doing some great work with fighters. First things first, what is it you actually do and why is strength and conditioning so important for fighters these days?
In terms of the stuff that I do with the boxers currently, all of it is based on science. Yeah. There isn't any guesswork used whatsoever. If I could sum it up, it was I recognised everything that you shouldn't do with amateur boxing.
Right.
And from there now, I've basically picked up on a number of things that I used to do, of which I still see a lot of professional boxers do. I'm about making the boxer the strongest version that they can possibly be.
Yeah, and it's quite close to your heart because you're obviously a massive boxing fan too.
So yeah, I had a lot of love for boxing, came away from that, did my degree at university, then went to learn more and get more hands-on, kind of in the trenches with a lot of strength coaches.
Yeah.
And from there, I've come back and recognised that the strength and conditioning side and science behind boxing is very outdated, to be honest, probably 20, 30 years behind other sports.
Are you sort of like departing from the old school type of trainer? Are your sort of techniques, give me an example of your sort of techniques, and are they more the sort of cutting edge sort of techniques?
Every boxer will have something that is different, that may be good, that may be bad. So you should never really train all of the boxers the same way, and that is a pattern that you tend to see if you go to a lot of boxing clubs. Everybody does the same thing.
Yeah.
They do the circuits, they do the sparring, they do the jump rope, they do everything pretty much in a group.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you get to a certain level, you need to be a lot more individualised, and that's some of the stuff that I'm doing now with a lot of the good up-and-coming prospects coming through, especially on the Manchester scene.
Right, okay. And you've got, and talking of Manchester, you've got your setup is in Manchester. I've been down there, converted warehouse.
Yeah.
Kitted out to the max, everything you need in there. Just talk me through this. I'm trying to get my head around this. When a fighter comes to you in the first instance, how do you sort of assess them? What do you do when they first come to you? Let's say I'm a fighter, come
good
to you.
Good question. And when I was working for Nike, I did a lot of, I did something called Spark, which was measuring speed, power, agility, quickness, reaction time.
Right.
or reaction time quickness, and that was with a lot of footballers. So for me, it was a big eye-opener, and that was probably 8-9 years ago now, as to why I was doing certain testing methods, and all of the tests that I did with the footballers were specific to the sport. So I thought there's got to be a way I can transfer those skills of testing over into the boxing arena.
Yeah.
So there's certain lifts that I would have a boxer do, predictor lifts of punch power,
right?
Hand grip strength, which will determine potential for hand injuries.
Yeah.
Vertical jump power, that will determine power of the legs. And when it comes down to punch power, there's a lot of aspects to look at, and just in boxing in general, in order to improve a boxer, you know, just one punch, whether that be a jab, a left hook, right cross, whatever it may be, there's so many aspects that you have to look at, and kind of figure out where is it that they're not as strong, and how can I improve that. A great example is a local fighter, Mark Efron.
Yeah.
Brilliant power puncher.
I felt his power on the pads.
And here's the scariest thing, he actually has the ability to become even stronger.
The thought of that guy increasing his punch power is actually scary. Mm. But that's interesting to note then. So you can get the sort of the metrics and all the data and the analysis, and you can actually take it to the next level.
Yeah.
Now, you touched on something really interesting there, and that's punch power. Now, every time I talk to fans of boxing, they're always saying, you know, especially, and also people just getting into boxing and white collar boxing and all the rest of it, they're always looking for techniques and how to improve their punch power specifically. Mm. And this segment is called The Sweet Science. So can you give us a little bit of a lowdown on how to increase punch power? Is there a way?
Oh, well, yeah, of course. So there's certain markers that I look for with boxers, and certain markers that I've created based on my experience in boxing, my experience testing other athletes in other sports, and also testing a variety of boxers and saying, okay, this guy's got incredible punch power, whoever it might be. This is what he scores on this, which is a predictor of punch power. So I'm going to use him as a benchmark. So I want every boxer to be chasing after this guy's punch power.
Yeah.
And the way I see them doing that is get them chasing after the numbers in the gym of what the strongest puncher is doing.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
typically speaking, underhand, chin up, you want to be looking at half your body weight attached around your waist. That's a good marker. Incline bench press is a brilliant marker as well for a straight punch. You want to be looking at maybe 1.25 times body weight for that to be a good mark. So for example, 100 kilo boxer wants to be doing an inclined bench press of 120, 25 kilo. So that should give you an idea based on your fight category. Times it by 1.25, and that should give you your marker of what you're aiming for. They're just two very, very simple markers. And if I improve the weight that those guys are lifting on them two lifts alone, then, you know, they're not just going to be hurting boxers with right hands. They're going to be hurting them with jabs, which is...
Yeah.
Brilliant.
And that's, it just shows you where the game's gone now, isn't it? Because you go back 50 years, it wasn't, it was just have a steak and you can, there you go into the ring. Now it's all done so analytically, you really can maximise the potential.
You would say that, but still, like I say, boxing is still behind by a lot. There's not enough emphasis on nutrition and placing the nutrition around workouts.
Yeah.
There's not enough emphasis on lifting in the gym.
Yeah.
Lifting weights in the gym, because there is a lot of old school mindset of saying, well, Mike Tyson never lifted weights. That's because Mike Tyson was a genetic freak with a serious amount of muscle mass, and he could knock people out, you know, just half-heartedly.
Yeah.
They want to take the sport seriously. They need to find out where they are individually weak, prone to getting injured, where they can improve on. And that's my job. I don't do anything with boxing technique per se. I do everything in terms of strength and conditioning. Nothing else. I don't dabble with that. That's the boxers. Trainer to do that.
Can you just like tell us a little bit about where we can get in, like, if anyone wants to get in contact with you, where they can get in contact with you, and where the gym's located?
The FLF Performance Centre is not too far from Piccadilly train station in Manchester city centre, so it's a really, really good location, local to the train station, maybe about 200 meters. It's a 7,000 square foot performance centre. It's got equipment from all over the world. We've got very good connection with Salford University Labs, so we get in there and do with VO2 max testing, blood lactate testing. Basically, you can find me through the FLF Performance Centre or Coach James Largey.
Yeah, brilliant. And just one last question for me personally, how'd you get those big guns that you got there? What do I have to do to get them?
That's a secret that I'm going to keep, but you know...
Will you tell me off camera?
I'll tell you off camera.
All right, okay. All right, well, listen, you've heard it from the... I mean, clearly, you absolutely know your stuff inside and out, and you're passionate about not just boxing, but just working with enhancing people, you know, to the best of their ability. This, of course, is Mr. Coach James Largey. Check it out. FLF Performance Centre in Manchester. You heard it. So we've just had James there, and obviously he really knows his stuff. So, I mean, you just mentioned there that you sparred with Terry Flanagan and Anthony Crawley. We're going to just go over now to have a little look at this interview we did with Terry Flanagan. So let's have a look at this. Yeah. I'm Aky Karim with Bbtv, our weekly show on www.britishboxers.co.uk. I've got the privilege of being joined by the WBO lightweight champion of the world, Mr. Terry Turbo Flanagan. Thanks for having us down here.
No problem.
First things first, you're out on the 26th of November in a big show in Wales. Are you just excited to be back in the ring after a long delay?
Yeah, I mean, Cardiff again. I mean, I boxed there last time. Won the best performance, still won a 12-round fight by about 18 rounds. But
yeah, exactly. Yeah. You say it wasn't a good performance, but you battered the guy and you had him go in, and what's...
He's just a survivor, wasn't he? Really. He should have got him out of there, but...
He's one of those cagey guys who knows how to survive, isn't he? Like, African champion and this and that.
Yeah, he was tough as well. He had that. He hurt both my hands in the fight, which which is hard, so...
Yeah. All right, well, you've got this guy, Orlando Cruz, who is actually... He's got a name in America, and, you know, people do follow him. What do you know about him, and what do you make of him as an opponent?
Yeah, he's good sort of opponent. I mean, he's been at world level, he's boxed for world titles. He's only been beat off like elite fighters like Saliba and stuff like that. It's a super feather stepping up to lightweight, so he'd be comfy out of the weight. And we're expecting a tough fight, but a fight that I think should be winning.
Yeah, I mean, does it kind of, I mean, do you find it difficult to get up for these fights where people expect you to win? You've mentioned some big fights coming up later on next year, perhaps. Are you still, is it just all business though? Are you still nice and professional for these fights, or are you a little bit disappointed it's not the sort of thing?
I mean, I'm disappointed it's not the unification fights, because they're the fights I've been asking for over a year now, and Frank Warren has made offers for them fights, and I know people on Twitter, like Twitter warriors, are saying he's not offering them proper money. Well, when I was turned down more money, what we offered them to fight, than it took for Crawler, so it says a lot about what I'm doing. I'm doing something like they don't want to fight me. And I'm pretty sure, pretty confident Frank's saying that he's promising me them big fights next year.
Yeah. Do you think you're getting avoided? You know, honestly, do you think you're getting avoided at lightweight by some of the other names?
I do, yeah. I mean, not avoided. I mean, if they have to fight, they have to fight. But I think likes of Slater Cannon. He took a fight with Garcia. He had his unification fight with there. He accepted the fight.
Yeah.
He went away touting that money about and took the fight with Garcia now. And when Alves got offered more and ended up taking the core fight. So it's not like we're not offering these fights. We're asking for these big fights. It's just that they don't seem to be coming off. But Frank's convinced me that next year is my year. And
yeah,
we're going to be going for them big unification fights.
Yeah, and I mean, you do deserve them as well. And you've got a great following. I mean, I went down to the Fana fight with your family on the bus, which, by the way, this man paid for, all his fans to get there and back. So I owe you about 50 quid petrol money, yeah? What have you got to say to your fans that just follow you, like, loyally?
I mean, like I say, they are top fans. I mean, they come up and down the country. They have done, the majority of my fans now have, what I've been there for my first fight when I fought on like a Sunday afternoon in Bolton on a daytime show, and they've come out again and they keep coming and they enjoy watching the boxing. The local people, you want to see a local lad do well, and it's good on them.
Now, I touched on this with Steve just a minute ago about you're not known as like a devastating knockout puncher, but the Magdaleno fight, for example, showed that you can bang when you want to. Are we going to see a little bit more of that side of you on the 26th, or are you going to be sort of looking to see what comes your way first and then just take it from there, or are you looking to go in for the big like photo finish?
I didn't do that with Magdaleno, to be honest. I got out and I got on my boxing, I was sharp, I was on it, like switched on, concentrating, and once he hit him, I seen I could take him on, and I've done that, and once you get someone hurt, 9 times out of 10 I finish him, and I think if we train right, like we have been doing, spot get the right type of sparring, you could see another devastating performance. Yeah.
Last time I saw you and Steve was at the, were you ringside for Crawler Linares? Firstly, do you think that was a fair result?
Yeah, well, keep watching it back, it was a fair result, I know. Watching the fight live, it looked like Crowe was going to go on and win the fight early on. I was looking at Robert Diaz
yeah.
And he was looking worried early on, like round 5-6, yeah. Until when I was hurt him, and then when I was switched off again and then picked it up for the last few rounds and sealed the victory. But yeah, when I was a great fighter, Crowe was a great fighter. I think it was a good fight of Crowe boxed well. It's the best performance I've seen from Anthony. And
it's the best I've ever seen
Linares
as well, to be honest.
Yeah, well, I wish him. Linares is a quality fighter. He's world-class operator. He's been up at that level for years now. I can remember watching him six, 7 years ago and thinking, what a fighter he was. So it's even more experience now, but Anthony can hold his head high, and I wish him all luck in the rematch.
It was nice to hear you say that, and well said, but like, you know, I didn't want to bring too much into it about Anthony, because I know, you know, you get tired of people asking you about this big domestic fight. But is that something you really want, or have you stopped kind of chasing that fight, or is it something you can see coming? Is it going to happen, basically?
I'm not too sure. I mean, like you say, I'm sick of people asking me. The fight's been offered to him on a number of times. I mean, he's obviously seen that he can win that Linares fight, because we offered him the fight after he lost, and he still chose to go down that route, so he sees that as the easier option. And it is a good close fight. Anything can happen in the rematch.
If he loses the rematch, I mean, touch wood, he doesn't, and I really believe he's going to actually win this time on points. If let's just say he loses, is the fight still there with you?
I don't know. I mean, coming off two losses, it's hard, isn't it? It's whether the public are going to be demanding it. They want the fight at the minute, so I've said, yeah, we'll get it on. But like I say, I'm looking for them big unification fights. I'm not going to be a lightweight forever. I mean, I'm growing out the weight rapidly, and if I don't, that the fight doesn't happen early next year or it's something at the latest, I can't see the fight happening. Really.
Fair enough. And I was actually, it's funny you mentioned the weight there, because I was going to ask you about this. I mean, you're currently at 135 pounds. Is a move to 140 on the horizon?
Well, we got offered the fight at 140. I mean, there was talk of Crawford vacating his WBO, and with us being a champion below, we don't matter. Step up and fight for the vacant title, but at the minute, I'm making lightweight. I think we can get them unification fights. It'd be great.
Yeah, I mean, I was looking at the 140-pound division this morning, and two names jumped out at me that you could go in the ring with. I'd love to see you in the ring with. But one was Broner. I mean, he actually might even be coming back down to 135 pounds.
Yeah, Broner stylistically, I think my style beats Broner the way
he hates people with a big engine, doesn't he?
Yeah, and fit and like what's he called? My Dan had done
to
him.
He
just beat him up, but I think I'd be more clever, use my feet, step back. So I think that's a fight I could win. And
definitely.
I'd say there's Ricky Burns as well.
He's
up there, but
he's a WBA champion now, isn't he?
Yeah, rival promoters, and I can't see that fight happening. But
if
I could get my hands on a belt up at 140, possible unification fight.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned their rival promoters. Do you reckon that's a factor? The fact that, I mean, Queensbury and Matchroom, perhaps they don't get on too great. Do you think that's a factor which might hinder you from some of these big fights?
Not really, no. I mean, the big fights are out there, and it's down for them to make them happen, the promoters. But I think it's more of an excuse, really, sometimes, where people look, he's with a different promoter, I'm with a different promoter, the fight can't happen. But it's easy, mate, because they've worked together before now and made them fights happen, so why not do it again?
Fair enough. And you're from a sporting family as well, actually. Your sister Chelsea's played this high level of football as well. Is it what's in the genes that just makes you guys, like the Flanagans, sporty?
I know, just a good sporting family,
yeah.
There's six of us, including me. One brother, five sisters, four sisters.
Is little Jake going to be a fighter one day, do you think?
Jake does a bit of boxing. He comes in on a Thursday night. And
He hit me a couple of times on the end, and I felt feeling it.
Bit with the amateurs. And my old amateur coach, he says he's better than I was when I was easy. So
nice. Hopefully we can just before we sort of wrap this up, and it's been a real privilege talking to you, I really appreciate it. In terms of, I've been asking a lot of the fighters this, who's your favourite fighter of all time?
Past and now current. Who's your favourite fighter, past?
I'd probably say Joe Calzaghe.
Yeah.
Past, yeah. And Manny Pacquiao today.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, two southpaw fighters who have looked up to from being young and
yeah.
Both got good engines, both high work rate, both fast, speed, skillful fighters who
yeah.
try and emulate my style, but I mean,
nice, nice. And the last question I'm going to ask you, do you see yourself as the best lightweight out there in the world?
Yeah, at the minute, at 135, I do think I'm the best out there. I mean,
yeah.
Say there is good fighters out there, but he's got to have them fights to prove it, and I'm looking to do that. I mean, there's big fights out there, and hopefully we'll see.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I really appreciate spending some time with you. So this is the WBO lightweight world champion, Mr. Terry Turbo Flanagan. He's out on the 26th of November. Make sure you tune in. I'm Aky Karim. It's BBTV, our new weekly boxing show. Power.
Okay, so some great footage there from Terry Flanagan. I mean, what do you guys think of Terry and what he's done for Manchester, current WBO lightweight champion?
Well, he's world champion, isn't he? So he's world class, and you know, from being from Manchester. And I think with Terry as well, what you got to take your hat off. I remember when he first turned pro, he was sort of just really under the radar, when he didn't have no great amateur career, and he just done it the right way, and just as he got up there to like 15, 16 fights,
yeah,
took, you know, a few big fights. Obviously, won the fights, and he's just got better and better since.
Of course, he was in the prize fighter as well, and
he won the prize.
He really
fight, yeah.
jumped onto the scene when he knocked out Magdaleno in two rounds.
Yeah,
that was a serious one. Like, what's your take? I mean, you've been in the ring with him. What's your take on sort of his skills? Because it seems to me like he's underrated, but he's absolutely elite. He's brilliant.
Yeah, I used to train with him with kids, so
yeah.
And he was only small.
Yeah,
he was only like a little small, and then. When you see him now, he's massive for the weight,
yeah.
And like, he's like the boogeyman at that weight.
He
no,
really
no,
is.
No one's gonna want to fight him because
yeah.
he's a southpaw. He's very awkward. He's very quick.
Yeah.
It ticks all the boxes that you won't want your fighter to fight. But
yeah, exactly.
Unfortunately, it's harder for him because no one want to fight him. But
do you think that's why he's not getting the massive fights?
Yeah, of course. Because obviously, look, he's very good, very talented, very dedicated.
Yeah.
So. These trainers are like, well, we don't want to fight him, we'll fight somewhere else. But now, fighters are going to have to fight him. You know what I mean? His name's out there now.
He's got the strap as well. He's got the strap.
He's got the WBO.
And, I mean, interestingly, I mean, there's loads of... I mean, look, you've seen some nice guys here. We've got boxing full of some nice characters as well. And Terry's one of them. He doesn't get himself out there as much, but he's a guy that spent 15 grand of his own purse money so that all his mates, friends, family could go down to Cardiff to watch him fight Fana. And I know because I was on one of the coaches. And he basically, that was all out of his own pocket. You don't see that too often. So he's obviously in that. You guys know him better than me. What's he like as a character, as a person as well?
Well, like you say, that says it all, doesn't it? Like, spending 15 grand out of his own money for his fans to go and, you know, support him.
Yeah.
But, you know, he's just like you say, he don't really like the media, he don't like the cameras and stuff. He's just a fighter, innit? He just wants to get in there and fight. And, and that's what he does. And, he does it very well.
What's it like to be in a gym surrounded by so much talent and so many people who are hungry, undefeated, you know, what's it like to be in a gym like that?
It's great, obviously, because you all bounce off each other, don't you?
Yeah.
So, you know, like, me, I've trained with, say, Zelfa since we've been amateur, and so we've come up together, and obviously now Zelfa's, like, you know, sort of leading the ways.
Yeah.
13-0 now, innit?
Yeah.
I'm obviously boxing on television and that, so... good because, you know, when you've come from the start, you know, from sort of from the bottom, you can see then, like, it gives you that belief as well to know that, you know, but if he's doing it, then I can do it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You all learn off each other. And obviously, you've got the lads, but Pat, our trainer, Pat and Paula, you know, I believe, world-class trainers, so they're leading the way, aren't they?
Yeah, and what's it like just to sort of, under the tutelage of Pat Barrett, because he's... You know, I've met him a few times now, and he's really passionate about the sport. And but he's a hard trainer, isn't he?
Yeah.
He's a hard trainer. What's it like to actually to be under that sort of tutelage and that sort of hard old school style?
Well, that's, you know what it's like now. It's like you don't know any different, do you? So it's just that's just the way he is. But that's what gets the best out of you, isn't it? Because like I think. It's funny, like, Zelf on Saturday, his fight lasted a minute, 10 seconds.
Yeah.
And he still had something to say.
He still gave me some after that. What did you do wrong in that fight?
He's like, you should have played with him like a cat does with a mouse.
Yeah. And like, what am I meant to do? You know what I mean? He's a perfectionist, but that's what gets you to the top.
Yeah. I mean, that's good. And I remember him saying to you yesterday about how when you first came in, but then it suddenly clicked and I could see how proud he was of you. Yeah. And that must mean a lot for someone like Pat Barrett to say, look, I'm proud of what you've just done there. That must really give you that sort
of... And obviously, because he is so hard, when you do get praise, you know then that you are doing something right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not like he's just blowing smoke up your ass all the time.
Yeah.
Because then it's, you know, you wouldn't appreciate it.
I'm not used to praise. If you praise me, I just praise him back like, oh, you got nice shoes. It's not normal.
Yeah. What are you guys like, though, when you're getting... Like, have you guys been hit flush? And what? How have you reacted to being hit flush? Because it's, you know, we can only imagine, you know, 99.9% of people out there couldn't be fighters. That's what makes you guys special. That's why I got so much respect for you guys. What's it like to be hit flush and how have you dealt with it? I'll go to either or first, but I want to hear from both of you.
Yeah, well, you just... I think a lot of, like, they say it all, like, a lot of taking shots is down to your fitness as well.
Mm.
You know, like, you see people take big shots, they might go down, but they get up and recover, don't they?
And
get through the rounds. But, yeah, I've took some big shots, and I'm confident that I've got a good chin, do you know what I mean? And obviously, you don't think of that anyway going into a fight, because you think, you're not thinking, oh, if I take a big shot, you're just thinking that you're not going to take a big shot,
because
your defence is too good, do you know what I mean? And
that's
how you've got to think all the time, and you're too switched on, but... Yeah, it's boxing. It's like swimming. You go swimming, you get wet, don't you? It's boxing, so you've got to be prepared that if you do take a big shot, you've got to come back with your own and recover.
Yeah. And Zelfa, in your two fights with, I think it was Jamie Quinn, you proved that you could go the scheduled distance and take some shots back and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, of course. Like, with me, it's more of an embarrassment if I get hit with a big shot. It's like Ben said, you're gonna get hit, but it's like, it's an embarrassment, so... I've not been hit with a shot where it's felt me, I'll rock me. It's like, you cheeky. It's my mentality where I think that's an embarrassment. Yeah. I'm gonna get you back for that.
You're gonna be out on the 5th of November on Bonfire Night. There's gonna be fireworks flying, and that's a serious good card. You're on that card, Mark Efron's on that card. Who else is on that card?
Matthew Ryan, Lyndon Arthur.
So that's going to be a serious good card. That's at Middleton Arena. I want to give a shout out to your Twitter and Instagrams and all that sort of stuff now. Do you want to...
Yeah. My Twitter is @BMulliganBox. My Instagram's the same. And obviously my Facebook, Sean Ben Mulligan. So yeah, any of them, contact me on there.
Get some tickets for that. That's going to be serious.
Sold out of ringsides now, so...
It's going to be live on BBTV as well.
Yeah, it's going to be live on BBTV
as
well.
That's why we bought him.
So obviously, if you can't make it to the fight, you know, tune in on BBTV and you'll be able to watch it on there.
Now, it's a whole gym full of seriously, genuinely nice, humble, down-to-earth young lads who are seriously good fighters too. And it's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you two. Like, seriously, like, joking aside, it's been an absolute pleasure to get an insight into what you guys do. And hopefully we'll do this again sometime. And these faces, hopefully, this is the future of boxing right here. Right, so I'm Aky Karim. This has been BBTV, our new boxing show. You can watch this show weekly and get subscribed. It's going to be really good. We've got some great content coming. This is, of course, Mr. Zelfa Brown Flash Barrett. This is Mr. Sean Ben Mulligan. Benny, we're going to come up with some serious good nicknames for him. Get those tweets in. Hope you've enjoyed it. Power.